In this video, we'll go over the main capital budgeting techniques, which are the NPV, the IRR, and the payback period. And alongside learning the theory, we'll practice using relevant examples on Excel. So let's get into it. Firstly, what is capital budgeting? And in short, it's a process a company takes to determine whether to accept or reject a project. These projects are usually large investments, like building out a new factory, opening a store, or creating a new product. And typically, this process is conducted by the financial planning and analysis team within a company. As for what's the goal here, it's simply to maximize the profitability of the business and enhance shareholder value. Looking at the NPV first, and the net present value tells us how valuable a project is going to be. The general rule here is that if the NPV of a project is greater than zero, then it should be accepted. That said, if the company has multiple projects with a positive NPV, but it doesn't have the funds to invest in all of them, then it should only prioritize on the ones that have the highest NPV. To show you an example, let's suppose we're working at Nike in their financial planning and analysis team, and the sales team is asking to open up two new Nike stores, and so our manager would like to know if that's a financially viable decision. For that, we're gonna have to use capital budgeting techniques to determine it. And here's the Excel file you'll be working with. You can download it in the description. So over here, you can see the different cash inflows and the cash outflows. Firstly, you're gonna have a big cash outflow that might be for acquiring the property or maybe doing the different renovations for it. And you can see we've got two projects, the first one up here and the second one just below it. As you can see, the second one's only a cash outflow initially of 250,000, while the first one is a lot bigger at 1.5 million. From there, you're gonna start to have some cash inflows. Hopefully, as the word spreads that this store is now open, there's gonna be more and more sales for it. Same thing down below. And as you can see, there's some cash outflows throughout that are gonna be fairly constant. These could have to do with the maintenance of the property, paying salaries, etc. Now that we know the cash inflows and the cash outflows, we can go ahead and calculate the net cash flow, which is simply going to be equals to the cash inflow plus the cash outflow because it's already in negatives. From there, we can just drag that along. Then we're just gonna copy that whole thing, so Control C, and then we're gonna drag it down over here, and the formula should update dynamically such that it's related to project 2 there, just like so. At this point, you might be tempted to just go ahead and get all the net cash flows and sum them, and that's gonna give you the net present value. But unfortunately, that's not entirely accurate. That's because of this concept in finance called the time value of money, which basically says that a dollar today is worth more than a dollar in the future, because if you have it today, you can go ahead and invest it and hopefully grow it over time. So to discount all these cash flows from year 1 to year 5, which are going to be in the future, we need to discount them using a discount rate that's gonna bring it back to the present value. And for this, we're gonna be using this 8%, which is basically the required rate of return for the company. With this information, let's go ahead and calculate the NPV. So we'll go down over here, equals NPV, that's gonna be the formula we'll be using, and here you can see the explanation for it. Press the tab key once you find it. The rate, like we mentioned, is this, comma, and then the value is gonna be from year 1 to year 5. Close those brackets, and then you're gonna do a plus a year 0, which is gonna be this net cash flow, and hit enter. And at this point, you might be wondering, well, why did you not put everything inside this formula? Why did you add it in the end here? And the reason for it is that the NPV starts counting in year 1. And so if we put everything from all the way from over here, then that would mean that it's counting for year 0 as year 1. And so all of the values would be distorted, which wouldn't be right. All right, so we've got a positive NPV. Now, what does that mean? Basically means that this project is going to add value to the company and therefore it should be pursued. So let's go ahead and copy this formula and drag it all the way down to the project 2 and just paste it over here as well. Double click on it to make sure that the right things are linked, just like so. And as you can see, this one's going to have a smaller NPV than the other one. Now, unfortunately, the NPV does come with some limitations. One of the main ones is the size of the project. In this case, if we compare the two projects, the first one is over $1 million in investment, and so that's why the NPV is actually a lot greater than this one over here, where it's only 250,000, and so the NPV is going to be a lot smaller. So it doesn't really account for scale very well, even though the second one may have a better return percentage-wise. The other limitation is the assumption we make for the discount rate. Depending on what rate we pick here, like say I put a 7%, as you can see, the NPV is actually going to vary quite a bit. Same thing if I put a 9%, now it's dropped all the way to 5 figures. So if we put it back to 8, this is what it looks like. Usually, when you assess whether a project is worth pursuing, you don't just want to know the dollar amount of the project, you also want to see the percentage return. That's when the IRR, also known as the internal rate of return, comes handy. In technical terms, the IRR is the discount rate that results in an NPV of zero. The general rule here is that if the IRR is greater than the cost of capital or the discount rate, then you accept the project. Let's hop onto Excel to apply it. It's just gonna be equals to the IRR, press the tab key, and the values are gonna be all of the cash flows over here. So go ahead and control shift and then right key, and that's gonna select all of them, hit enter. That should give you around 10.38%. Control C to copy that, and then let's just paste it down over here, and control V. As you can see though, this time, even though the NPV is greater in project one, it has a lower IRR than this one over here. But that being said, both of them should be approved based on this as they're higher than the discount rate or the cost of capital. Now suppose these two projects are mutually exclusive, meaning that the company can only afford to do one or the other. In that scenario, as you can see, it's a bit confusing here because you've got a higher NPV for the first one, but you've got a higher IRR for the second one. And so which one should you prioritize here? And generally, you prioritize the higher NPV as that's the one that's maximizing shareholder value the most. As for the limitations of the IRR method, among the more obvious ones is that it doesn't give you a dollar value of that project. Also, sometimes the cash flows of a project aren't very linear. For example, you might have a net cash flow that's negative in year 0 and another one that's negative in year 3 as there's a renovation or something like that. And if you're liking this video, you can also check out our course where an investment banker, a financial analyst, and myself teach everything we know about finance, valuation, and financial modeling on Excel. First, we cover financial statement analysis using Apple's real annual report as an example. Then, we get into financial modeling through a three-statement model. After that, we begin the valuation phase where you learn to do a discounted cash flow, a comparable company's valuation, and a present transactions valuation on Adobe, looking at the real financial statements to eventually derive a valuation range. Lastly, we'll show you how to present an investment thesis using a stock pitch format. So if you're interested in checking it out, go to a link in the description below where you'll find a discount code. Alright, back to the video. Next up, we have the payback period, and this is simply how long it would take the company to recover its initial investment. So basically the time for the project to pay back for itself. Generally, the shorter it takes, the better, but there's no strict maximum rule for this one. It very much depends on the company and their financial position. Hopping onto Excel to calculate the payback period, firstly, we're gonna need to calculate the cumulative cash flow. That's gonna give us the payback period after that. So equals the cumulative cash flow in year 0 is just equals to the net cash flow. However, in year 1, it's equals to the net cash flow of year 1 plus the cumulative cash flow from the previous year. And just go ahead and drag that across like so. And as you can see, just looking in plain sight, you can find that the payback period is probably around 3 point something, as in year 4, you already have a positive cumulative cash flow. And so it's somewhere around there. So for this, we can manually go ahead and go equals 3 plus. And then to find that decimal or that 3 point something, we can go to absolute. That's gonna give us only positive values, such that this value here that we'll select is positive. And we're gonna divide that by the net cash flow in year 4. Close those brackets and hit enter. That's gonna give you 3.91 years. That's the time it takes us to pay back for the investment. If we wanna go ahead and reformat this a bit, we can go to Control 1. From there, under custom, go ahead and select this whole area, so Control A, and you're just gonna put the number sign dot number sign twice. And then we're gonna go quotations, put a space, and we're gonna put years, close the quotations and hit okay. Now you can see it says 3.91 years. For project 2, it's gonna be the same thing. So firstly, let's go ahead and copy this and we can paste it down over here as the formulas are gonna be the same. Press the F2 key to verify if they're looking good. From there, for the payback period here, we can also just go ahead and copy it and paste it. And the reason we can just paste it here is because it's also gonna be between year 3 and year 4. If it wasn't the case, then we would have to modify it as this formula is quite manual. So press the F2 key there. And so that 3, you would have to change to whatever you're seeing. And same thing goes for the absolute here, you'd have to drag that across. Now there is probably a better way to do this with a formula, but it's gonna be quite a long one. And so that's why we didn't wanna get into it. One of the main limitations of the payback period is that it doesn't account for the time value of money. To combat this, there is what's known as the discounted payback period, which is slightly modified, that you would basically go ahead and discount all of the net cash flows first. And from there, you will get the cumulative cash flow and eventually derive a payback period that's discounted. Also, this method doesn't consider any profits, returns, etc. And instead, it's only focused on paying back the project investment. With all these capital budgeting calculations that we made, we would be able to tell our manager to go ahead and proceed with both stores. That being said, if they are mutually exclusive, meaning we can only pick one, we would suggest picking the first one as it's the one that has the highest NPV. Comment down below if you have any questions, and if you want to learn more about discounted cash flow specifically, check out this video over here, or go ahead and check out our course on finance and valuation over here. Hit that like, hit that subscribe, and I'll catch you in the next one.